way, she had a problem with the billboard, so we're going straight to
you. Okay, come straight to me. Good evening. This is Execution Watch. My name is Ray Hill, and I am the usual host of this. We are produced by Elizabeth Stein. We have a little trouble with the billboard tonight, so we won't begin with the wonderful voice of Larry Douglas, but he will be on the show, as will Susan Ashley and Jim Skelton. We also will have an interview today with Steve Wood himself. At Steve's request, I went to Livingston last Wednesday with a crew, technical crew, and Elizabeth, and interviewed Stephen through the glass in the death row visiting room, checking with the Attorney General's office. We discovered that Stephen had exhausted pending appeals, so we're waiting on word from Huntsville if the process has begun. And as soon as Elizabeth gets that set off, we will have Gloria Ruback on. Gloria Ruback called me earlier from the station and said she is on their way. I'd like to take a personal privilege thing as the host of this program. This is the first program where we have tried to speak with the person who is being executed and is interviewed in this show. That changes the paradigm for me. Normally, I come in here and I host this show, and I've agreed to do this on the basis that I can read the names, and I frequently report the execution to people that I either know for other reasons, or I have communicated with. But this is the first time in several years of doing this show that I actually saw and talked to Stephen. That is an emotional difference for me than it is for the other shows that we have done. We will proceed as usual. We get a report from Huntsville about the progress of the process, and Elizabeth is setting that call up now. And then we will go to another activist who is at a vigil here in Houston and give them encouragement. And then we will go here into a discussion of what happened in this case. What the evidence shows from the trial and the hearings, various hearings, what happened in the case. And then we will report what is the legal history of this case, trial, rounds of appeals, what happened to the issues that were raised. That is the way we do this. And so if you're a first-time listener, you're listening by several arenas. Either you're listening on broadcast KPFT FM 90.1 here in Houston, or you're listening on the HD 1 channel of KPFT's radio station, or you may be listening through the KPFT website, kpft.org, or you may be listening from our own website, executionwatch.org. Elizabeth is getting the call set up, and as soon as she puts that on hold, I will then communicate with Gloria. Elizabeth is making notes in the process, and the telephone line went dead. So I don't know if we have a report from Huntsville or not. Elizabeth, can you give us a report from Huntsville? Well, not having a report ready for Huntsville, billboard didn't work tonight. We're having technical problems that we haven't suffered the whole thing. Who's going to tell me what happened in this case? Susan?
Okay. The facts of the case are this. Okay. Stephen Michael Woods and Marcus Rhodes were both charged in these murders. Two people were murdered. There was a young man named Ronald Patrick Whitehead, who was 21 years old, and Bethina Lynn Braz, who was 19. Both the young man and young woman were killed. What happened is, in May of 2001, two golfers were driving down a Boyd Road at Tribute Golf Course near Colony, Texas, and they came upon the bodies of Ronald Whitehead and Bethany Braz. Both had been shot in the head, and both people had their throats cut. The male was dead, and the female was still alive at the time the bodies were found, but she died the next day. So, obviously, police were called, And that same evening, police received several anonymous calls to Crime Stoppers where people reported that Woods was involved in the killings and that Marcus Rhodes was involved in the killings. So detectives went out and interviewed Woods. Woods admitted being with the victims the night before, but he said that he was leading them in a car to a location or a house, but the two cars became disconnected during the trip, that he left them and he returned to the Deep Elm section of Dallas. Woods was not arrested after this interview. Detectives also then they interviewed Rhodes, and when they interviewed Rhodes, they also searched his car and they found items belonging to the male and female Whitehead and Bras. Both victims' backpacks were found in the trunk of Rhodes' Mercedes, and Rhodes' fingerprints were on weapons, and his car was littered with shell casings. There were guns registered in his name that they apparently found under his bed at his parents' home in Dallas.
But those were not the guns used in the killings.
We don't have any information what guns were used in the killings or what gun was used. Because essentially the police obviously recovered that gun from Rhodes and Rhodes was arrested, but Woods left the Dallas area. After the interview with police, Woods left and he traveled from Dallas. He was in New Orleans, he was in Idaho, and he was in California. He was finally arrested in California and police interviewed him when he was arrested in California. Now, several witnesses told police and testified at the trial that before the killings that he had told these witnesses about his plans to commit the murders, and then after the killings that he told them about his participation in the murders. And people had told that to the police, and they testified to that effect at trial.
And this case was tried in Denton County?
Yeah, one of the things I want to mention.
I need a microphone here. Hold on just a second. Let me get Gloria on. Gloria? Hello?
Hi, Ray.
Hi, Gloria. Tell us what's going on in Huntsville.
Well, there's about 10 or 12 of us out here, well, including three nice people from a television thing in France. But the execution is happening. The media went into the death house. Steve, fiance, mom, and I'm assuming brothers went in to witness. So the execution is now taking place. There's a group here. There's about 15 people in Austin. So there's protests going on around the state. And I want to let listeners know that there's four executions coming up. There's another one Thursday. And I want to invite people to a press conference tomorrow at 3:00 in front of the Harris County Courthouse, where the death penalty abolition movement and Quan LX and some other activists are going to be making a demand that Pat Lykos intervene in this execution, because the execution Thursday of Dwayne Buck revolves around a black man who was sentenced to death because he's black. He had a psychiatrist testify that his race determined that.
Yeah, the internet is pretty much covering the language of that psychiatrist that's right. Saying on the issue of dangerousness, he's black or Hispanic, therefore he's dangerous. But I want to stick tonight's show to Steve Woods' case. And
okay.
But I appreciate your making the announcement. The press conference is tomorrow at what
at
time?
At 3. Yeah, 3:00 at 1201 Franklin in front of the Harris County Courthouse. Dwayne Buck's sister, who survived the shooting, will be there to speak out for a stop to his execution.
Okay, Gloria, keep us posted on what's going on in Huntsville. Elizabeth has another call lined up for me.
Okay, all right. Okay, bye-bye.
That was Gloria Ruback, who Gloria Ruback, who is with the abolition movement, and she is our witness in Huntsville. And I guess this is Dave. Is this you? Whoop, Dave is not there, Elizabeth. And so that did that. So, but Dave Atwood is at a vigil here in Houston. And we were fixing to go into Jim. What happened in these trials? Anything remarkable about the trial?
Let me tell you one of the problems we have in evaluating these cases. All we're able to get or the appellate opinions, that doesn't necessarily reflect all the evidence introduced at trial. So we don't know whether or not there were ballistic evidence introduced at trial. It was just never an issue on appeal. Because, see, what we have, we only have two opinions to look at. We have the direct appeal from the Court of Criminal Appeals that affirmed the case. Mm-hmm. Then we have the record from the post-conviction writ. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't reflect all the evidence introduced at trial. I suspect, however, had ballistics tied the murder weapon to the co-defendant, that would have been an issue on appeal. But we don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know.
Yeah,
I mean,
you've got two cases.
Right.
One of them went on appeal.
Right.
We don't know that the other fellow's cases were appealed, do we?
No, well, he entered a plea of guilt and got life without parole. He wouldn't appeal that. Are you nuts? Because then they'd come back and try him for the death penalty.
It was a bargain.
No, he isn't going to do that. And the issue, the big issue that I had a problem with on appeal, the two issues, I think Larry had a problem with the limitation on voir dire during the trial. And by the way, is it Woods or Wood? Is it an S on the end? The opinions say S,
yes,
Woods.
Woods. Woods.
Woods. Yeah, Woods. Okay. The thing I have a real quarrel with is they...
Wait a minute. I've got Dave Atwood finally has gotten here. Dave, where are you and what's going on?
Well, we're out here at the corner of Woodhead and West Alabama, right in front of St. Stephen's Church.
St. Stephen's Church tonight.
Right. And we've got a good, pretty good turnout here. I think we had 7 or 8 people here. I think we come back for a hot day out in the sun, or almost in the sun anyway. That's where we are. We're, you know, I think I said before, we have a lot of cars go by this corner, hundreds, really.
Sure.
And so it's a good place to get our message out, Ray.
Okay. That's not too far. Where's the Peace and Justice Center these days?
Where is it? It's over at the Houston Mennonite Church is where we have
it. Okay. You have your office at the Mennonite Church.
But there are a lot of... activities that go on at St. Stephen's Church. There's the Houston Interfaith Justice Group has their office here, and the pastor of this church, Lisa Hunt, is very a progressive person, and so there are a lot of events that take place over here at St. Stephen's, and she's very receptive to us being out in front of her church and doing our protest against the death penalty. In fact, she comes out and joins us every now and then.
All right. Really nice. And to learn more about you and your organization, folks can go to www.tcadp.org.
Texas Coalition to Abolish the Death Penalty, right.
Thank you, Dave.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.
I'm sorry, Jim.
Oh, no problem.
He's confused tonight, and they're going nine-way directions from Sunday.
See, the problem I have with this case, the only problem I had with the direct appeal was this. Number one, in this particular case, the co-defendant Marcus Rhodes confessed to the police and incriminated Woods.
Yes.
Now, Woods never confessed to the police, although he made damaging admissions to friends of his. Now, here's one thing that really bothers me about the direct appeal. And I must say this. Judge Price wrote the opinion. He's considered a good judge for the defense bar. Now, what happened, and you have to understand hearsay. And I don't want to make this too lawyerese. Hearsay is simply a statement made outside the courthouse that they're offered to tell the truth. They say it's truthful.
Yeah.
And one of the exceptions to the hearsay rule is if you make an admission against your interest. Because the question on hearsay is this reliable statement. So if I make a statement that incriminates me, they're going to say that's reliable. I wouldn't be fessing up to that.
Okay.
And that's called, the lawyer term for that is admission against penal interest.
Okay.
Now what happened, they called two witnesses, a guy named Samuelson, a gal named Swartz. And here's what they testified to. They testified the co-defendant, Marcus Rhodes, told them prior to the killing that Woods had a job that he wanted Rhodes to do and Rhodes didn't want to do it.
Okay.
After the killing, they claimed that Marcus Rhodes came back to them and said that Woods took their credit card from the dead man, ordered some items off the internet, had them sent to a friend to divert attention from him and shift it to his friend. Now, they admitted those statements under a penal under that exception, admission against interest, because Marcus said it. He's incriminating himself.
And it's your opinion that that should not have been admitted.
Well, here's why. every hearsay statement also violates the confrontation rule, because the Sixth Amendment says you have the right to confront those that accuse you. And I thought this violated the confrontation rule. There's a case called Crawford versus Washington. There's a jillion cases that discuss this. And I thought it violated the confrontation rule. They sneaked around that by saying that this was not, quote, a testimonial statement, because when Woods, when the co-defendant said that, he didn't anticipate, the witness didn't anticipate that be used for later prosecution. I have a real problem with that. And the reason I have a problem with it, because there was no physical evidence linking Woods to the crime scene so far as we know. The only way they linked it to him was his prior statement to the police that he was with the victims, the two people, the night before the night of the killings. That's somewhat confusing. And led them to a house. There's nothing in putting him at the crime scene, as far as I know, no DNA evidence, no anything. All they had were admissions made like this. And I think that would be very damaging, because if the jury believed what these two witnesses said, that puts Woods at the crime scene, that puts Woods being actively involved in it, and that's based, to me, that should have, he never had right to cross-examine those people. Okay. I thought that was wrong.
We have another person. We have someone calling in who is Woods' aunt, and we're going to put her on the air. Hello? To whom I speak?
Hello?
What's your name?
My name is Abby Youngby. I am actually sitting here with his boy's mother.
Okay, go ahead, please.
You know, it is a travesty of justice that's going on here. The fact that we can sit here and thank God your program's out there, sir, because, you know, we're wondering what his last words are going to be. He's never met his children. You know, had this gone in any kind of way, had, you know, the Marcus Rhodes father not been some, you know, high-profile CPA in Dallas, you know, there might have been more of a look at this case. Because there was just, you know, judicial misconduct all through it. He was denied several rights. You know, they didn't put anybody on the stand for him. The lawyers. I'm not Steve's aunt. I am an aunt to his boys.
Oh, okay.
You know, this boy, these boys need family.
Okay.
You know, they're losing their father today.
I understand.
They need somebody
now,
to stand
ma'am,
and say something for him.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
I'm reluctant to open the radio show up to calls. I appreciate your calling in. Give my sympathy to the whole family. What we have to go on here is what is in the record.
I just wanted to let you know you are stating things that are not the case. You know, his DNA, you know, it was also reported down in the Texas News that his DNA was on something. His DNA was not.
We have not, ma'am, we have not reported his DNA is on anything.
This is just other.
Yeah, but we're not others. What we are reporting on, and we are scrupulously careful to be ethical about reporting what is in the record. And as my attorney has just told me, that this record is very lacking because all we have is the appellate record. We do not have access to the trial record in this case. So we do not know what was introduced in trial and what was not. So we are reporting what we have found in the record, and we have not reported that Stephen's DNA was found at the scene or anything near the scene. We are reporting that the record does not have that evidence contained in it.
That's because it was stricken from the record. There's also two judges down there.
Ma'am, are you saying that Stephen's presence at the scene was stricken from the record?
Yes, sir.
I think that works out to Stephen's disadvantage. What we are reporting is that the record does not indicate Stephen was even present.
Well, exactly.
Okay.
The only DNA that was found was Marcus Rhodes, sir.
Okay.
And
we don't.
It so that the appellate could not hear it.
We do not have a record of Robert Rhodes' trial because he never had one.
Right. Oh,
he pled. There was no trial. There were no appeals. But
right.
Thank you very much for calling.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, ma'am. I don't know. We're going to have to establish some ground rules around here if we're going to continue to do the show, because I think, thank you, Jim Skelton, and thank you, Susan, for reporting accurately what the record shows. I think we want to stick to that. I think Gloria is wonderful at telling us what she thinks about things, and we accept that. But if we open this up too broadly, we're not going to do Stephen or the other people whose cases we cover here. And it's time for me to ask the wonderful voice, Mr. Douglas. Mr. Douglas, what have you found in all of this?
Well, in my opinion, under the law and as the procedures go, the appropriate thing appears to have been done. I've got a fairness issue, okay, that was just totally outside the law. That is that when I look at the limited record that we have, and that's just normal in all cases. We have a one man going to death row, and another person serving a life sentence without parole, who did in essence something very similar. So I've always have concerns about prosecutorial discretion. Particularly as it relates to who's going to get the death penalty and who's not going to get it. And that's just the overall general concern that I have in this case. But he was selected for as the one to receive the death penalty, and it appears that he got a reasonably fair trial based on how trials go.
And the looks of the appellate thing. And is there any reason to believe his appellate attorneys were less than adequate?
No, in fact, if you're looking at his lawyers, his trial lawyers were just great. Okay, they did an excellent job in representing him and then tailoring the evidence in such a fashion to his best interest. But the appellate lawyers did an adequate job also.
Isn't there a hazard if you try a case in your absolutely Johnny on the spot that you limit the chances of even getting an appeal?
You always have an automatic appeal on a death penalty.
On a death penalty, you have automatic appeal, but you may not have anything to talk about.
Well, not always, because if you read these death penalty cases, a lot of them are sent out there written on a word processing machine. But in this case, I'm going to add to what Larry said. You know, it's always fashionable to blame the lawyers. One of the problems they had, the lawyers were pretty well hamstrung. I see you got a call coming. We'll talk about that later.
Gloria.
Yeah.
You're on.
Hello?
You're on.
Oh, okay.
What has happened?
Steve's family just came out. The execution is over. And the ordeal of four executions in 8 days has begun. We're waiting for Stephen's fiance to come down here and join us, but she has gone into the administration building with the family. So it'll be a few minutes.
Okay, Gloria, we're going to go back because I think what I want to do is play Stephen's tape.
You want to? Oh, okay.
Okay.
All right, great.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And we'll talk to you later. That was Gloria Ruback. What she reported is the witnesses have come out of the building, and that means they, at the beginning of the process, the witnesses come out of the administration building, they cross the street, and they go into the walls. Inside the walls, they are conducted through a rat maze, and they get to the execution chamber. The process begins. When it is over, Steve Woods is dead. And they have come out and crossed the street and gone back to the administration building. What has happened to Stephen right now is that Carnes, the person with a contract to deal with the bodies of people executed on death row, are taking his body to the Huntsville Funeral Home. The family members may go there and touch the body while it still contains warmth. I know that sounds dreadfully morbid, but this is the first time that anyone in Stephen's family have had an opportunity to touch him since he got to death row many years ago. Now, I've got a room full of people who've got wonderful and important things to say, and we will be back to them. But I think what I would like to do right now is to play that 20-minute interview that Mark Pirtle recorded between Steve Woods and I last Wednesday.
Where you come from, Steve?
I come from just around Detroit, Michigan, Livonia.
Wow, it's cold up there.
Yeah, well, it's nice. It's not 110 degrees.
What brought you to Texas?
I was trying to get to California. I was hitchhiking. I've been on the street since I was about 16 years old. I got locked up when I was 21, so I spent the most of my adult life out there. I was just trying to get to California, and I wasn't the best geography student. Ended up landlocked in Dallas.
Is that where your case is?
My case is in Denton County.
Denton County?
Yeah.
Denton County is in Burling County. I always tell my friends, don't do anything.
Yes.
Denton, Williamson, Montgomery County.
Right, right.
Those are the worst. You can get a lot of time in Denton for things that would be a civil case elsewhere.
Oh, yeah.
So, but you know all about that.
I do now, yeah.
You mind telling me what happened?
They say I have a law parties case.
Mm-hmm.
And that only came out after my appeal. What happened was a man named Marcus Rhodes and I and my friend Ron and his girlfriend Beth all went to go do a drug deal.
Okay.
And Marcus ended up killing Ron and Beth in front of me. Well, he killed Ron in front of me and he killed Beth while I was hiding in his car. And after that, they convicted me and sentenced me to death. I really don't
Were you tried together or separately?
No, I was tried separately. I was tried first.
What happened to him?
He got life sentence. Life
yeah, with, so he's the guy that beat the, got the cops first.
He got life with parole. He was arrested first, and he never when he stood up in court and confessed to it and took his time, he never said anything about me. He never had to testify in my trial.
Mm-hmm.
What it was is his parents are pretty affluent in Dallas. He lived in Highland Park. And
I've run across those kids.
Right. His father works for the Justice Department and played golf with a district attorney in Denton County, Bruce Isaacs. So they tried me first and let him live.
What do you know about what he did?
He killed Ron right in front of me. I was actually sprayed with a little bit of Ron's blood when he was murdered.
Tried in Denton County?
Tried in Denton County.
Tell me about your trial.
My trial was a farce. There was no physical evidence linking me to the crime, no eyewitnesses. All it was a bunch of Marcus's friends got together and got up on the tip of the stand and said that I was bragging about the murder after it happened.
So any evidence that would directly connect you to the murder would have been hearsay evidence?
Exactly.
They heard you say under different circumstances and things. Mm-hmm. And these were people that were close to your...
Yeah, there was one jailhouse snitch who, when Marcus was arrested first, I was arrested several months later in the state of California.
So you got out of the scene, you were headed west.
Right. Somebody was arrested and put in the tank with Marcus. Was let go from jail. I got arrested, extradited. He was put in a tank with me solely for the purpose of getting information.
Oh.
And he testified that I had told him everything that happened and all this. It's since, during a post-conviction investigation, we got him to say that he lied on the stand. But my attorney wasn't very competent, didn't include it in the writ. Barely even had anything to do with it.
How long have you been on the road?
Been on the road for 9.5 years.
9.5 years.
9.5 years.
And so this is like a new beginning for you.
Oh, yeah.
A new beginning altogether. Because is someone working on the records of that, him getting out of jail, getting transferred to West Coast, or ever how that was that he wound up in the tank with you, or?
Because there's expenses involved. He waited until I was extradited.
Okay, he didn't get close to you until you were back in jail.
He got locked up for a simulated controlled substance charge.
Okay.
Fake methamphetamine,
yeah.
Which is a fake charge.
Quick buck.
Yeah. He was also under investigation for murder, and he had defrauded the University of North Texas for $25,000. As soon as he testified against me, they dropped the fraud charge, let him keep the $25,000, dropped the simulated controlled substance charge, which would have put him back in prison because he had 11 years on his parole to do,
mm-hmm.
and just completely dropped the murder investigation.
So it gave him a walk in exchange for
exactly
incriminating statements or evidence.
Yes.
You, and that, too, was hearsay.
Yes.
I heard him say
yes. They tried to pull some physical evidence and link it to me, a rubber glove, because all the fingerprints on the weapons were Marcus's. They were found in his house, under his bed, It was a 380 and a little Derringer pistol.
Whose gun was it?
One of them was Marcus's mother. The other was his. They're big game hunters. They have all kinds of guns and trophies. Marcus has been a professional killer since he was 7 years old.
So the weapons were traceable to him and his family?
Yes, yes.
And there was nothing. You traveled around the country with empty pockets, right?
Pretty much. I had a laptop and some clothing.
Trail makes you very vulnerable in these kinds of situations.
Oh, yeah. And I was incredibly naive to the legal process and the whole situation. I didn't know what I was getting into. I was way over my head.
How old are you now?
I'm 31. Yeah, I was middle-aged right about that time. I was 16 years old.
16?
Yeah.
So they had to qualify you as an adult?
No. I'm sorry. When I got down to Texas.
Oh, okay. 16 years when you got to Texas. So how old are you when the case happened?
21.
And you're staying in Denton?
I was staying in Louisville.
Louisville.
With my fiance and her parents. And broke up with her and started staying back on the streets. I was with her for about 6 months in her house. It's the only time I ever had a stable living situation.
Mm. And then when this came down, you had to head out.
Mm.
Gotta keep on rolling.
Yeah.
What were you going to do with your life?
I really didn't have any plans. I was just going where life took me. From here to there, in New York City.
Drugs played an important role in that.
Hmm?
Drugs played an important role.
Oh, yes, yes. From 16 to 19, I was a junkie. So it's just where the junk took me.
Wherever the junk took me.
Yeah.
That's a lifestyle. A lot of people don't understand that. But,
oh, yeah.
That's not an uncommon lifestyle.
Oh, God, it's so incredibly hard to break, man.
How long have you been on the road?
I've been on the road for 9.5 years.
9.5 years. Know a lot of people. Seen a lot of people come.
Seen a lot of people go, man.
Some of them get out because they were under 18 when it happened. So you've seen the road. What is road life like?
For me, it's about 23 hours a day just trying to ignore what's going on around me. I don't like to get involved in prison politics and all the he said, she said crap that goes on back here. So I just stay to myself and read, study.
What do you read?
I'll read anything that comes in front of me. I was trying to learn how to speak German for a while. I already have Russian down a little bit. I love classical literature. I love science fiction, fantasy.
Yeah, imagination stuff.
Yeah. I was a dreamer when I was a kid.
I'm a playwright and an actor. That's where the radio comes from. It's play Lois Lane. You listen to Prison Show?
Yes, I've been listening to Prison Show since I've
been doing it right?
Yeah, definitely. The only thing I can say is you don't have enough phone lines.
Well, we've only got, David is working on that actually. David is working on a system whereby as soon as we go on the air, he will get 20 people on the line and then cut them off.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's going to take him,
He's
counted 20. I could do on a good day 30 in an hour. And I don't force people to hurry, but then I don't chat a lot.
Right.
I look for something funny. Try to get a little laugh going on down the cell block. Not many laughs down there.
Right. Yeah, when I first got here and I heard you talking about hollering down the pipe chase, I'm like,
what? The hell is that? Previous generation. Yeah, it would be the cell blocks in the old days are back to back cells, and there's pipe chase in between the two cells. And if you were on the right floor, you could holler down the pipe chase and talk to a friend on the other end. Of course, everybody, including the man, was eavesdropping on what you say, so you weren't getting away with any sneakers. But
and you could actually have to holler, so,
right in the morning.
Right.
I did the prison show for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
9 months and 2 weeks.
Man, so you've been there,
But I keep remembering being here. Not the Polanski, but the Ramsey.
Ellis. Ramsey. Oh, Ramsey.
I did most of my time to Ramsey as maintenance and construction bookkeeper. I went out with a 160-year sentence, and within a week, I was outside the compound in the maintenance shack. And within 6 months, I was had a pickup truck as the construction bookkeeper, so I arrived to another unit and checked my sites.
Right.
They don't run prisons like that anymore.
Yeah, no.
I went back to the Ramsey, and there were two free world people sitting in the office that I used to occupy by myself. But you don't know anything about general population. You didn't do any time other than this.
No, this is the first time I've ever been locked up. I was in trouble as a youth with sexual harassment, but I got probation for that.
Little time in jail?
No, I didn't do any time in jail.
Really?
Yeah, it was, I was like 14. The girl
went, oh, okay.
It was a friend of mine.
And you didn't have to wait out of trial. It just resolved it right away as a juvenile.
Right. I pled no contest, got probation for a year. Did about 2 months of it, and they discharged me from the probation.
Okay. So you don't care much for the other people in the room?
A lot of them, no. Not really. They're just not my type of people. There's a lot of manipulation and games played, and it's just, I try to stay out of.
Where do you think that comes from? Think the system may have treated them?
I think it's a lot of
trained them that way.
A lot of it has to do with the fact that this is a very different situation from what most people are used to. Being locked in a cell for 23 hours a day, they lose something up here, and it makes them.
Yeah, but the very operation was bound to leave mental effects and scars.
Right. But a lot of it also, they're like that on the streets, and they come here. And
you grew up here, 21 to now?
This is, yeah.
Boy,
did I grow up. When I first got here, I was one of those knuckleheads that was always running off at the mouth at the guards, getting sprayed with gas and running on. And,
oh, yeah.
I'm sure you saw plenty of those.
You finally gave up on that.
Oh, yeah. Once you run your head into the wall enough times, it kind of sinks in, look, this is probably the wrong thing to be doing.
And but that was really kid stuff.
Yeah, that was kid stuff. That was a lot of anger, being locked up, being locked in the situation.
What do you do with the anger?
Right now?
Yeah, what do you do with that? It's got to be there.
I write.
Yeah, got to be.
I'm a writer. That's where writing is the best therapy I've ever come across.
What do you do with your writing?
I either give it to people, throw it away. Mostly it's for myself, so I throw a lot of it.
I know that stuff's valuable.
I mean,
this tape is valuable.
Yeah.
Because you're sitting over there. You may as well be naked.
Mm-hmm.
You're exposing yourself to a guy you met, what, 20 minutes ago.
Right.
But you've heard my voice, so.
Yeah. I mean,
you know who is Ray.
You've been there for 9 years, man. So. I mean, I've heard more of you than I've heard from my family.
But you got friends.
Yeah.
Because they called me.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they called me and said,
they bugged the hell out of you,
said,
probably.
Stephen wants to do this. And I said, are you sure? Yeah, I'm sure. So, well, tell him. But Michelle and I get along reasonably well. She thought I retired, too, but not from execution watch.
Right.
Since this is your first time up, I think it's very high likelihood you're going to get a stay this time.
That's what I'm thinking, especially with my attorney. I mean, I'm scared to death right now, but...
Well, of course. I mean, you can hear the bell tolling.
Oh, yeah.
And for whom the bell tolls, that's a piece of classic literature.
Mm-hmm.
But it's your option after the stay, what I do with this tape. This is your tape. And if you want me to come back at some future date or just throw the whole thing away, all you got to do is let me know.
My mother.
Okay. Where's your mom?
She is in Livingston today.
Livingston.
She had come up to see me previous to this.
Oh, okay.
She has a special visit with her tomorrow. And I have holiday visits with her on Monday.
Where does she live?
She lives in Michigan.
Michigan. Mm-hmm. A lot of politics going on in Michigan.
Yes.
You know, I sometimes wish I could pack up and go up to Wisconsin, Michigan, and get my hands in. I come from like a bunch of labor goons.
Yeah.
My parents were labor organizers, both of them.
Oh, that's nice.
So I come by prison show stuff.
You get the labor show right before the prison
stuff
show.
From the labor goon background.
Right.
Yeah. So that's exciting. How often does your mother get to visit?
She visits once a year for the last few years. I haven't had barely any contact with her since I've been here. This is really hard on her. Harder on her is on me.
Of course, it's harder on her. Yeah, I know people. I run around with Hurricane Carter. Mm-hmm. After he got out and went to Canada, he and I had a joint gig at Santa Barbara, California.
Yeah.
And he said he wouldn't let his family visit. Mm-hmm. He said he didn't want to see them that way.
Yeah. The issue I have in the courts right now, if it gets me a stay, it'll give me a new trial. And if I get a new trial, I'm not.
It's like a new start.
Not coming back.
It's like a new start.
Yeah, because I know I can win.
Well, I hope you can get something done about Denton County.
Yes. Well.
If you get a new trial, maybe you can get a change of venue because Denton County is not the most kind place.
The head district attorney who presided over my case is now a defense attorney. And I was thinking. I was thinking, if I go back, that's going to be my attorney.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know how. You know, one of the great blessings of my life is that I'm not a lawyer.
Right.
and that's real. That's up front with me.
That's next on my agenda.
Hard to get a lawyer to expose his own dirty laundry.
Right.
I don't care what side they're on, where they are.
Oh, yeah. I was fortunate in my case here because I'm filing ineffective assistance of state habeas counsel.
I read that. I read that, and it's on. I've got it. That's on my Facebook.
Right.
So I'm at not Facebook, but on my website.
So you've read where
executionwatch.org.
You've read where my state habeas counsel admitted he messed up.
Yeah. You have an admission.
Yes.
On habeas appealed. And so that would give you another sequence,
right?
At a minimum.
Right.
And so, why do you think they set your date?
I know why they set my date. Prison politics.
Prison politics.
There's a gang here in this prison who have a hit on me because of some website stuff. So the captain of that gang sent a letter to one of my friends saying that he's going to start having people call Denton County Courthouse and ask them why they don't have an execution date yet. And so he did that, and 2 weeks after I got kicked out of court, I had an execution date.
Have you had any dealings with the gang?
When I first got here, they tried to pick me up. And I talked to them for a little while. And it's a white supremacist gang. I'm not white. I'm Armenian. So,
yeah, Jewish boys don't do well.
Right.
Or Armenian boys. Or so, Turkish boys.
So when I found out they messed up, they you know what happens with that. So he getting all on my case.
I want you to look into this camera for about 3 or 4 sentences. And I want you to talk to those people. Now, let me tell you who those people are. They're all over the world. Some of them are in Armenia. Some of them are in Saudi Arabia. Some of them are in Australia. And a good many of them are in England and Germany and Western Europe. You're sitting on death row in Texas.
Yes.
What do you want to say to them?
I have no idea how I got here. I don't belong on death row. I've never killed anybody. I've been involved in some pretty heavy in my life, but I don't belong here.
Could this happen to anybody? Well, almost.
Yeah, almost anybody. If you don't have money, if you're a minority, you're on the wrong side of somebody's door. I mean, this can pretty much happen to anybody.
Or at 21, if you're still a naive kid.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely that too.
And chemicals. Man. Don't help.
Drugs put me here.
What are you going to do about that? That addiction's not going to go away when you get out of prison.
I've been clean for...
Sure.
a long time.
It's not hard to do here. It's harder to do out there.
Yes, yes.
But you don't have any running buddies to go home to.
Exactly. I got a whole new life.
You got a whole new life. And who have you met while you were here?
I met Tali, who has been a godsend.
She's the lady I talked to.
She's the lady you talked to, and I'm going to marry
the her. Lady with all the enthusiasm about my coming and interviewing.
The one that's running around like a chicken with her head cut off. Yes, and she's going to be at the prison show on Friday. Yeah, I was blessed to have her in my life.
She's around Houston giving talks to groups all week.
She'll be here to see me with my mother tomorrow, and that is going to be an adventure.
Yeah, it is. It's the first time they've been together?
It's the first time they've met, yes.
Okay. And you're excited about that.
Oh, yeah.
See, you actually do have a life.
It's like pitting the Christians against the lions.
Well, now that may be an overstatement.
Just don't show that to my mother.
Stephen, are you all right?
Yeah.
You going to be all right?
I'm going to be all right. Even if the worst happens, I'm going to be all right.
Even if the worst happens, I'm going to be all right. That's difficult for me to listen to. It's difficult for me to remember. It will remain on Execution Watch, the website, for as long as any of us are in any condition to maintain it. You have any comments?
You know, this show tonight represents one reason why I hate the death penalty, and also represents my frustration in talking about it. Because, number one, when we get prepared for these shows, all three of us, Larry, Susan, and I both, read all the opinions. We know what were said in the opinions. And then we hear a lot of accusations that have no basis in fact. And when you try to correct them, they accuse you of being a prosecutor.
Sure.
And it's real frustrating because, as somebody once said, a zealot who believes in his cause has no end of lies he will tell to support his cause. And I don't think that does both of us opposed to the death penalty. It doesn't do us any good to have people exaggerating facts.
No, Jim, I want us to stick to our principles. We're crossing the line. You're attorneys, but in this case, you read what's there and you
exactly.
report what you find.
Exactly.
And I will defend that, as I have on this show.
Right, because you did earlier with the lady. I thought, my God, all of a sudden, Ray's become the prosecutor and you're talking to the aunt. Because
No. I defend what we do in the show because I think we put enough kind of thought into it. Susan, were you treated or mistreated in this show?
Ray, you know better than to mistreat me, Ray. No, I've been treated wonderfully. And I try to report the facts. I mean, part of what I talk about when I start is I go over the facts of the case. Now, those are the facts that are coming in the record. And we don't have the full trial transcript. We're working off the appellate record.
You're working off the appellate record is all you had in this case.
That's right.
There are cases where we have more records.
Yes, it's just that...
The problem, Ray, with the death penalty case, usually the records are voluminous at the trial level, and that's with the district clerk's office, and we can't get that. And all we know is exactly what was reported at the appellate level, and that doesn't necessarily...
So they cherry-pick the issues.
Well, it depends on how well the defense lawyer does the brief. That's all we agreed is what were the controversies. Because in a death penalty case, their record will fill up two or three boxes, and it'd be impossible for us to go through everything in the trial record. Number one, it's in the district clerk's office in whatever county the death penalty case occurred. We'd have to check it out. And it'd take us 2 weeks to go through the whole record, the trial record. So all we get is kind of a bird's eye view of what they seem the issues were at trial. This doesn't necessarily mean that's all the evidence introduced at trial. And what we do is read what goes on at trial. I went before, and get ready for these shows. I look at every record that we get. I look at the direct appeal, the Court of Criminal Appeals. I look at the writs in state courts. I look at the writs in federal court. I look at the writs in the Supreme Court, if there's any published opinions. I'll read all of those, and I summarize them. So I get a bird's eye view of what the issues were at trial that the lawyers wrote about. But that doesn't necessarily mean...
I mean, you got a whole picture.
Whole picture. But what I get frustrated with is what I said earlier, is when someone says something that's not based upon the record, and you try to correct them, they start fussing at you that you're bleeding.
But Jim, we don't have any choice.
I understand.
But to stick to the procedure that we've got. And the procedure that we've got, Larry, I think is a sound one.
And I didn't fuss at Larry about stuff.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah, well, they argue when they get out of here. And
we argue before.
They argue here. Right. I mean, we've done that. I want you to know that it's very difficult for me to listen to the interview I did with Stephen, because when I did that interview, I was thinking this is your first set date, and statistically it's a higher likelihood that you're going to get a stay. And he was beginning to indicate with his Tally, his friend, and his mother that there was an emerging life, probably for the first time since he has been alive. He had no life as a punk druggie on the streets. And now, at the end of this saga, he was developing one. Larry, did any of that impress you?
Well, circumstances really have a profound impact on people. And a 31-year-old Stephen Michael Woods is probably after being on death row for 9.5 years, is likely a much different person than the defense lawyers saw when he was trying to prepare this case for trial. If he had the same attitude at the very beginning, I think he would have done himself a whole, but he was a different person back then. So the person who was executed, in all likelihood, is simply not the same person who the holding shows was involved in the crime. He's a different person.
Well, we didn't get to discuss, we haven't discussed yet the punishment phase of the trial, of what came out in the punishment phase. And apparently what came out in the punishment phase is that when Woods was arrested, picked up in California, he gave a interview with a police detective in California, and in that interview he admitted that he was involved in another murder. And that probably, that might have had an impact. That was presented, the
also
jury
also might have made a mistake. I mean, come on, of course it had an impact.
Jurors heard that, and that would be something they would consider in their deliberation.
You know, I don't know a 21-year-old fellow, a copy of the 31-year-old guy I talked to. I don't know how much of assistance he could have been to his counsel at 21.
One of the problems, Ray, when you read the Red opinion, is that he wouldn't cooperate in presenting mitigating evidence. He wouldn't cooperate with the lawyers. And that's one of the problems they had. In fact, as a matter of fact, there were three mitigating specialists that talked to him. The second one spent a lot of time with him alone in the room. And she said, there's no way in the world I could ever testify he wouldn't be a future danger. Get somebody else, but do not let them meet him face to face. Do nothing but look at the record. So obviously, he made a terrible impression on the mitigating
expert. That's exactly my point.
Yeah.
At 21 years old, I do not know that he could have been much help. I've just received.
He wasn't any help. He's horrible.
Yeah,
apparently.
I just received a kite from the executive producer that I've got to yield to. Elizabeth Stein is the executive producer. We couldn't do this show without the wonderful direction of Otis McClay, and technically assisting us not only in getting that interview, but also in preserving this record, is Mark Pirtle. The videotape of today's show will be attached to our website. I want to thank, of course, Jim Skelton, Susan Ashley, Larry Douglas. I want to thank our board op this evening. Doyle has done a wonderful job of balancing with all the technical difficulties we began with. The theme music is by Victoria Panetti, and unfortunately, we will be back this coming Thursday as Texas plans to execute Dwayne Buck. Despite some racist testimony in his expert witnesses. My name is Ray Hill, and I do this not because I want to do this or like to do this. I do this because I believe this needs to be done.